On September 1st last year, a team of 16 scientists published a paper that shook the foundations of what we know about the universe. They observed distant galaxies with the James Webb Space Telescope and discovered something utterly surprising. The common understanding was that the universe underwent rapid expansion before cooling down. Then, the first stars and galaxies started to form, during a time we call the Dark Ages. But here's where scientists started scratching their heads. These ancient galaxies looked as developed as our own Milky Way. It's even much more mature than astronomers anticipated, which could only mean one thing: that they must have existed way before our galaxy. Now, why is that a big deal? Apparently, this finding of ancient galaxies is going to challenge our understanding of how the universe began.
There is a Big Bang, but the Big Bang was not the beginning. People tend to think that if you have a model in which it keeps on going in some sense, and your Big Bang is not the beginning, that you've got to collapse back.
So, a fundamental question arises. Is it time to reconsider what we think we know about the Big Bang and the origin of time? Before the early 1900s, most scientists thought the universe was static and unchanging. It means no expansion, no contraction, or any other changes taking place. But all that changed about a century ago. Astronomer Vesto Slipher noticed some nebulae were moving away rapidly. He first thought it was because of our galaxy's motion, but more observations from the Lowell Observatory in Arizona didn't support this idea. That's when Edwin Hubble stepped in. He showed a clear pattern that the further away a nebula was, the faster it moved away from us. And what's more interesting is that these discoveries matched what general relativity predicted, that space-time could stretch or shrink. And so, if we trace back the universe's expansion using Einstein's equations, we land on the idea that all space, mass, and energy were once squeezed into a tiny point, a singularity. We often hear that the universe began with this singularity, followed by the explosive Big Bang. If we think about it, the scale of the universe is mind-boggling, and the events just before the Big Bang are still a mystery. Now, if everything started from that point, what existed before it? Was there really nothing, no space or time, before the singularity? In order to understand how the rewinding time went back billions of years ago, let's consider this scenario. Think of our universe like the surface of any balloon. Here we have to introduce the concept of scale factor. The scale factor is like a ruler to measure the balloon's size. Right now, our universe is blown up to a certain size, which we call one scale factor. But some time ago, this balloon was only half as big. Now, two dots will be drawn on this balloon, so if we blow it up, the dots move farther apart. And that's the expansion we mean. So in some future moments, the scale factor for this balloon will be larger than one. Now think about letting the air out of the balloon slowly. As you do, everything on the surface comes closer together. If you could completely deflate the balloon, you'd have a tiny, flat piece of rubber. This is a bit like the singularity, when the whole universe was very close together, extremely hot and super dense.
If you extrapolate those equations back in time and try to predict what the conditions were at earlier times, you come to a moment 14 billion years ago, when the temperature and density become infinite.
But just when you feel you've grasped this bizarre notion, it turns out the picture might not be so clear. Currently, there's strong evidence suggesting we shouldn't take Einstein's equations all the way back to a singularity. For instance, observations hint at a time just before 10 to the negative 32 seconds, when the universe underwent a super-fast expansion, known as cosmic inflation. Cosmic inflation offers valuable insights into the universe's expansion at a vast scale. It tells us why the universe looks so consistent and how galaxies came to be. In a way, it solves several puzzles in the Big Bang theory. But still, the singularity is a condition of intense density on a minuscule scale, where quantum forces play a vital role. So, just using general relativity alone, we can't fully grasp the phenomenon of singularity. This early rapid expansion helps iron out issues with the Big Bang theory. We might need to rethink this whole Big Bang singularity concept, since it will probably reshape our understanding of cosmic inflation and the beginning of the universe. So, what truly unfolded at the start? It turns out that the peculiar nature of the Big Bang singularity suggests it might not be the whole picture. Mathematical singularities in a physical concept usually raise some eyebrows. They often mean the theory has gaps or has been pushed to its limits. And that's where we stand now. We've rewound the universe using general relativity, but this theory isn't all-encompassing. At the extreme densities and temperatures of the Big Bang singularity, general relativity clashes with quantum mechanics.
We're not really sure scientifically that there was a beginning to space and time. In fact, we've been exploring the idea that when you actually replace Einstein's theory with an improved theory of gravity, that you'll find that the Big Bang was not the beginning, that there existed space and time beforehand, and in fact, the key events that created the large-scale structure of the universe and even all the galaxies and stars, all those events actually occurred before the bang, and we only exist here because of those events.
Sir Roger Penrose provided us with a new framework of thinking. He asked us to imagine what or who's in this universe eventually, if we fast forward time to infinity.
Who's in this universe eventually? Not us. The black holes will all have evaporated away by Hawking evaporation. They've swallowed galactic clusters. What's left in the universe? Pretty well photons. That the photons reach infinity without realizing anything funny has happened, if you put it like that. Infinity in this conformal picture is just like anywhere else.
So let's imagine that matter in the whole universe will eventually be dominated by photons. As you might have realized from relativity, the trouble with photons is that they don't feel the passage of time. Why, you might ask? Let's break it down. Think of space-time like a grid in the fabric of cosmos. We can measure separation on this grid using the space-time interval equation. Here, the term tau is the time we feel, and the term ds squared is a variable to measure the space-time gap, or separation. For us who are stationary, our movement on this grid is all about time and not really about space. I mean, we're still traveling through time. So the equation now becomes this. It tells us that the separation the object travels in this combined space-time world is just based on time. This time distance relates to the speed of light and a special kind of time interval. Now, if we had something that could teleport, let's say in the x direction, its motion would be all about space. So we're left with this equation, which means two events in the space-time grid that happen at the same time, but at different positions in space. But photons are truly unique. They travel along a specific path known as null geodesics, a route taken by anything moving at the speed of light. What's fascinating is that photons move in such a manner that they don't experience time or space. They're instantaneous. This is why their space-time interval becomes d squared equals to zero. So imagine this. You turn on a flashlight briefly and then turn it off. The instant the light shoots out is event A, and the moment it reaches a certain point away from the flashlight is event B. The space-time separation between these two moments is ds squared equals zero. That's because the photon moves from A to B simultaneously cruising through both time and space, in a way that they offset each other. This unique way of moving means that photons lack a rest frame. They don't possess a personal clock as the rest of us do, so they never feel time passing by. This special behavior matches up with a fundamental idea in physics, that no matter where you are or how you're moving, light always moves at a consistent speed. If photons had a stationary reference point, it would appear as if light isn't moving from their view. This very fact contradicts our understanding of the speed of light. Also, the equations governing light are the wonderful equations due to James Clerk Maxwell, aka the Maxwell equations. These have a very interesting property. It lies in the fact that the equation couldn't tell big from small. The vastness of the universe, or the smallest quantum particles, are all the same if we use these equations. For instance, if you have a system in which you've got some electromagnetic field, and you could stretch this system to bigger or smaller, it wouldn't notice the difference. This phenomenon is called conformally invariant.
If you don't mind stretching or squashing, then you could step outside this universe to another side to it. So I want you to imagine the same thing here, that you've got the Big Bang, which is somehow stretched out to be a one-time surface, but you could go before it. This mathematical trick, if you phrase condition on your universe in this way, you say you could extend to before, then that is a way of characterizing the initial state of the universe.
As Penrose explained, if we put the concept of an infinite universe in this conformal picture, every conceivable space is just like anywhere else for massless object. Because essentially, it's only mass that knows the difference. So although massless things might perceive all spaces the same, they lack the ability to mark time. This is when Einstein's theory helps us track when the universe started. Einstein told us that energy and mass are basically two sides of the same coin. But another important equation came from Max Planck, who said that energy and frequency are linked, E equals HF. If we put these two equations together, we realize that mass and frequency are connected. This means anything with mass, like a rock or an apple, has its own beat or rhythm. And so without mass, we wouldn't have a clock or time. In the end, Penrose's argument eventually leads us to this, that the very remote future is indistinguishable from a Big Bang. When the universe has become basically empty except for photons, it would be as though it had transitioned into a new Big Bang phase. Our universe's future could become another universe's beginning. This concept, often referred to as conformal cyclic cosmology, challenges conventional ideas about the beginning and end of our universe.
If you're thinking about a cyclic model, it was conceptually wrong in the first place. It's conceptually wrong because the picture focus has you turn your focus to the scale factor. And what I want to argue is that you really want to have your focus on the Hubble radius. Because if you talk about what makes a universe cyclic, what you mean is that from cycle to cycle, the universe should look the same.
If we're looking at the model, the Hubble parameter shows how quickly the universe expands. Initially, the universe was a super tiny ball, just 10 to the minus 25 centimeters. And this ball bounced very high, powered by a whopping energy of 10 to the 15th GeV. As it rises, the speed eventually slows down, and so does the universe's expansion. When it descends, the Hubble parameter drops back, and the universe shrinks back to 10 to the minus 25 centimeters. But just like throwing a ball into a trampoline, the moment right before the ball lands, there's going to be a push. This is our universe's dark energy, and in our case, it causes a contraction. The nudge from the dark energy makes the universe keeps expanding, again and again, in a continuous cycle. This phenomenon mirrors the conformal cosmic cosmology model, which says that the universe keeps expanding and contracting in a cycle.
And more generally, what we're trying to do is make a theory which is complete and tight, where the past, the present, the future are all interlocked.
To get a feel for this, you have to think about the seemingly simple concept of now. In our day-to-day lives, we experience time as a continuous flow, but it can also be useful to think of time as a sequence of moments or snapshots. Everything that happens can be thought of as the unfolding of moment after moment and after moment. Now picture these moments lined up, every earthly moment and every event in the entire universe. This would capture every occurrence that has ever happened or will ever happen. Every place in space and each point in time, from the start of our Big Bang to star formations in the Milky Way to the birth of planet Earth about 4.5 billion years ago, and even to big events this summer. All these events, happening simultaneously but in different places, define our sense of now. You can picture them on a single slice of space-time. Let's call it a now slice. We'd like to think we all agree on what's happening right now, moment by moment. But Einstein showed that, strangely, when you take motion into account, this common-sense picture of time goes out the window. If you think the region of space-time from this cyclic cosmology model, we realize that there are different ways to cut this region to represent the individual now slices. And from special relativity, we know that someone who is moving will have a different conception of what's happening right now. And so the way they'll intersect this region of space-time will be at a different angle. It won't be parallel to our version of slices. Picture an entity in a galaxy 10 billion light years from Earth. And way over here, we have a person reading a newspaper. If the two are sitting still, their clocks tick off time at the same rate. And so they slice the same now sheet. But now see what happens when this entity moves away from Earth. The entity's now slice cuts through the region differently. It means that the entity's present moment on Earth skips back a millennium, to times when Vikings sailed the seas, or when the Great Pyramid of Giza was built. If this entity moves toward Earth, its now slice leans into Earth's future by about a few thousand years. It might glimpse events like humanity reaching a Type II civilization level, or perhaps colonizing another galaxy. Anyhow, this concept of time slicing is especially important when we consider again the case with photons. There now includes the past, present, and future simultaneously. Just as we believe that all space exists, so does all of time. Everything that has ever happened or will happen, it all exists, somewhere and sometime. From Andy Warhol introducing pop arts to the world, to the end of the Cold War. From our first time riding a bike, to events that are yet to happen on other planets, it all has its place in the tapestry of space-time. This idea is just like what Einstein mentioned some decades back, that the distinction between past, present, and future is only an illusion, no matter how persistent they might look.
Is time universal? In other words, is there an audible tick-tock throughout the galaxy? A master clock, so to speak? The answer, my friends, is no. Time is not absolute.
So let's recap where we stand now. Penrose says that the universe restarts endlessly from the big explosion to the next round. But it means it is even harder to track the beginning or ending of the Big Bang in this cyclic model. And so, in this intricate cosmic landscape, we catch a glimpse of the intriguing possibility where our universe is constantly growing and creating new universes within itself.
Most of space would be this stuff, which is continuing to inflate. And then it would produce quantum fluctuations that continue the inflation further, while maybe producing other patches where inflation ends. And this would continue literally eternally. And we call this eternal inflation.
When combining quantum physics with gravity and introducing inflation, the outcome is eternal inflation. In this scenario, most of space is always inflating, with pockets where inflation has ceased. And due to quantum fluctuations, some of these areas resemble our universe, while others don't. An infinite number might appear like ours, but an equally infinite number will not. This leads to the idea of a multiverse, where every conceivable event or scenario will occur infinitely, given the universe's physical ingredients. With such infinite possibilities, the probability of a patch resembling our universe is astronomically low. Recent events have cast doubt on some aspects of this idea. In March 2014, the Bicep 2 group from Antarctica claimed to have detected cosmic gravitational waves, some touted as the conclusive proof of inflation. However, it was later revealed that the observed waves were not cosmic in origin, but patterns created by light passing through the dust of our galaxy. Instead of proving inflation, this discovery raised more questions. Recent findings have set stringent limits on gravitational waves, excluding many simple inflationary theories. This led to a renewed focus on the foundational assumptions of the Big Bang theory. Some theorists are now revisiting the idea of the Big Bounce, an alternative to the Big Bang. In this model, the universe's smoothing and flattening don't result from a high-energy random quantum origin. Instead, it emerges during a time resembling our present, where classical physics dominates. This model proposes that the universe undergoes periods of slow contraction instead of rapid expansion, eliminating the multiverse concept caused by random quantum fluctuations during inflation. The Big Bounce theory also has its predictions. It suggests a universe devoid of cosmic gravitational waves because of the absence of energy concentration. Multiple experiments are ongoing to determine the presence or absence of these waves. Another significant component of this theory is the idea of a cyclic universe, where the universe undergoes periodic bounces. This proposition is currently being tested through experiments and observations. The findings from these studies will not only determine the origins and future of the universe, but will also establish the relationship between gravity and quantum physics. These discoveries will shape our understanding of the universe's nature. If the multiverse theory is correct, our observable universe might just be a random occurrence, detaching us from understanding its fundamental creation. But if the bounce theory is right, our observations would represent the universe as a whole, giving insights into its fundamental laws. These upcoming experimental results will have profound implications on our comprehension of the cosmos.